Yeah, baby, Rockland, Maine, we're coming. A lot of people are coming. Tony Atlas, Mr. USA, Dr. D. David Schultz, Adrian Street, Joe Savoldi, Phil Apollo, everyone's going to be there. And of course, your tag team champions, the people's champions, we're going to be there to take care of business. We don't care who we got to take because we are number one.
I'll tell you one thing, national television coverage, that's what it's all about. So the people at home can watch tag team champions of the ICW. Bring it to you. The belts are on the line. Anybody that wants them, got to take them from us first because we are number one in the ICW.
Right here.
October 10th at Rockland High School. Don't miss this one. Come and see Dr. D. David Schultz, Jumpin' Joe Savoldi, Exotic Adrian Street, and Mr. USA Tony Atlas. Tickets are available at Kayla's Store, Economy Sports, and Seaport Office Supply. And we'll be taping for national TV, so make sure you're there.
About him that I don't trust, that's for sure. Boy, you can't be misled. You're right. Miss Linda accompanying him up the steps.
And we have seen her wreak havoc in the past.
Yep.
There she is. She is the valet. And you know the Exotic One's attitude about Miss Linda and all women. They should be seen and not heard.
Well, mouths are open across this entourage. People cannot believe their eyes.
Yeah, well, they won't believe the rise, too, because we know what he's capable of doing inside that squared circle. And as I said, the prancing and the dancing and all the color and the flair and the charisma better not mislead you. This is one mean, vicious, and cruel individual, a man who enjoys hurting his opponents. His winning percentage throughout his career, Steve, is absolutely incredible. He has met and defeated opponents wherever he has gone. They become mesmerized by what they see, and they forget what they know about the man in studying his record and in taking a look at what he has accomplished in this tough, tough business of professional wrestling. And I don't care what the man looks like or what he does. You take a look at what he does inside that squared circle and the number of victories that he has scored in his career versus the matches that he's lost, and you will find that this is indeed one very tough hombre. And Miss Linda, let me tell you, has aided and abetted him in various dastardly ways in achieving that winning percentage.
I'm trying to figure out those earrings.
And as we see, you know, by the way, did you notice that the two of them are wearing matching outfits again? You kind of wish they'd switch sometimes, don't you?
Boy, she has got bracelets and everything galore on.
It's called baubles and bangles and beads.
Look at Adrian Street.
That's, you know, what that was almost a flying monkey flip, but applied in a very unique and, well, maybe fashionable.
Particularly good track record. The banker there asked, what do you want to have?
That's right, he's got a short arm scissors locked on. Although I can't quite see Miss Linda spoiling my vantage spot. Well, maybe she wasn't because I was looking right at her. But now we're looking into the ring. The Exotic Adrian Street. Take a look at the way he's got Mickey Gilligan, his younger opponent, wrapped up there. The man's all business. distract the opponent and aid him in winning his matches. Because winners make money in professional wrestling, Steve. Losers don't make the same kind of bread.
Very true. True words never spoken. And Adrian Street going to town.
Did you see that unique move?
Yeah. No question about it.
Now take a look. And watch the way this man handles himself in the ring. He's a master of ring savvy.
And you know, Milt, you see something like this, and you've got to say to yourself that a man like this cannot be, well, some of it is self-taught, but he had to get his training somewhere.
Well, he was trained in England. And in England, they wrestle in various weight categories. They weigh so many stones, as they say, the old metric system. Take a look at that hitmaker. Very, very uniquely applied by the exotic Adrian Street. And it has, look at the effect, because Mickey Gilligan really... You know, let me tell you something. A guy that the fans react, the exotic Adrian Street, as being less than a man, shall we say? A man who is less than a man does not throw punches, kicks, judo chops with the kind of force and devastating effect that are as they're throwing by the exotic Adrian Street. It's his way of projecting himself and his personality, and it works for him.
No one else but him. Here he goes now at hard right.
You know, whatever his preferences are outside the ring or his preferences, if he chooses to flaunt them to the people, that's up to him. Take a look at this. The way he's got the leg wrapped around, bending back. Can you imagine the pressure being applied to the hamstring muscles of Mickey Gilligan as are being applied by the exotic Adrian Street, notwithstanding that ridiculous hairdo?
Oh. Boy, the left leg of Mickey Gilligan has to be stretched to its extent.
Well, the hamstring, that's the major muscle at the back of the leg. And Gilligan, you can see he's just been absolutely rocked and socked throughout this match by the exotic Adrian Street. And look at that punch right to the solar plexus.
And now Miss Linda right below Gilligan, but as in the past, she... used to perhaps maybe exert a little bit of extra punishment on her opponent, but she just stood there, so we'll give her credit for that.
Well, the exotic one did a little prancing, a little dancing, but Gilligan wasn't watching. He was trying to catch his wind. You know, Steve, I'm just looking. We've got the exotic one's feather boa sitting right here, and I was just wondering how it would look on you.
I don't want to even touch it, let alone look at it.
Chicken.
Jeez, that's what they are, too, probably, chicken feathers.
Well, I've never seen a purple chicken before.
All right, Adrian Street now.
Look at the quick move.
Yeah.
He was waiting for Gilligan, gave him a shot at himself. Gilligan attempted it, but Street showing he's a vet, an absolute ring veteran. His winning percentage doesn't belie itself. You take a look at what this man's doing inside the ring. That was a good right hand, forearm smash, down covering the man. Well, Mickey Gilligan showing he's a game young competitor, kicked out from underneath. But I don't give him too much of a chance for the rest of this match.
Gilligan wearing a lot of the makeup and cosmetics of Adrian Street that have managed to come over. Look at that now.
Being kicked right through the derriere by Miss Linderson. Get back in that ring.
Those are pointed high heels, too.
And sprung in over that top rope by the exotic one. Don't you love the matching outfits that Miss Linda and the exotic Adrian Street wear constantly?
Love? Love is a strong word.
Don't they turn you on?
Adrian
body press. Had the knee right across the throat, but the count of two. Only Gilligan, game young competitor. You know, I see a lot of potential in this young man. I think he's got a long way to go if he sticks with this professional wrestling game.
Well, he's going to learn a lot in this match, that's for sure.
Sure. Listen. You take punishment, you learn how to avoid it next time. You don't sign a contract to wrestle the exotic Adrian Street.
True. All right, referee Fern Jolin now checking over Gilligan. Ah, elbow.
Good short, short right arm, forearm smash. Look at the way that flying arm scissors. Roll them over, roll them up the guard of three. You have to be impressed. You have to be impressed by the moves that we displayed by the exotic Adrian Street, who once again is victorious here on International Championship Wrestling. And wrestling fans, as Rhea gets a nice kiss from the exotic
ladies and gentlemen,
Steve
West
looking very hesitant.
Exotic Adrian Street.
The man who rushes. He does come in now, that's for sure. to me.
Frankie Burke is a part. Frankie Burke weighing approximately, well, pretty close to the same, about 300 pounds, refusing the preferred handshake. And he shouldn't have taken it, Steve, because Mokovic, the mad Russian, looking to give Frankie Burke a set of match, set of cauliflower ears.
Well, he's going to work quickly, as would have been expected. And look at this. Not going to win many fan favorites here, that's for sure.
Tossing Frankie Burke out of the ring between the second and the top rope. 300 pounds, facing close to 300 pounds. There's one difference. The weight's distributed just a little bit differently on the body of Frankie Burke versus the body of Mokovic, the mad Russian.
And as we say, the mad Russian, just a long line of those gentlemen, we'll say, that come over from the Soviet Union to exhibit their wares and their talents. Look at this, coming down real hard now.
Elbow drop, count of two, but you know, you don't knock it because of the origin. But one thing that I've got to say, a man that I've respected and admired for many years, Ivan Kolob, perhaps the first of the Russians, a man who's kept himself in such marvelous physical conditions over the years, and a sensational athlete, sensational wrestler. You can't take away from the ability of a man like Mokovic, who's in obviously excellent physical condition simply because of the country of origin. Let's face it, there are many North American and European wrestlers whose attitudes are at least as bad as Mokovic.
No question about that, but the one main difference, I guess, Milt, is he can come here, we can't go there.
That's true. That's true, and he does like those capitalist dollars.
No question about it. It's not that he's refusing the money.
Rubles don't go very far when you're on vacation, do they?
We don't pay in wheat, right?
You know, and it's unfortunate for Frankie Burke that right now he's the object of derision and the man that, hey, a nice reversal by Burke, and a good hip toss coming down with the round mad Russian Mokovic showing. You know, you may think that that's a terrible thing, that Mokovic beat it out of the ring, but it actually is ring savvy and ring smart, Steve, because why stay in a ring when the other guy's on the roll? Come out of the ring as Mokovic just did. You take away the momentum.
And as he's showing, he's going to take as much time as possible.
Well, why not?
Yep, no question about it.
If you can dictate the ebb and the flow, yep, whatever the game it is, basketball, football, hockey, when it's a non-stop game, why not dictate the flow and the motion of it? If it works to your purpose, and it is working for Mokovic. Take a look at the way he just laid that big boot in across the throat, and now this seems to be a favorite maneuver. Cauliflower ears about to develop on both sides of the head of Frankie Burke. Snap heavily to the canvas, and Mokovic showing he's as strong as anybody you're going to find inside the world of wrestling.
Wow. And Frankie Burke coming in at close to 300 pounds for this as well. It's very difficult to lift that dead weight. Look at this!
Dexterity is...
Wow!
That was a 300-pound man that went up in the air.
Standing drop kick.
One of the greatest drop kickers anybody's ever seen. You got to see it. The man known as Sweet Daddy Zeke. He used to be able to do it from 6 inches away. Standing drop kick and nail his opponent right on the button, right on the chin.
Love to see it when executed properly.
Well, it's a crowd-pleasing move.
Oh, yeah.
Very dangerous as well, you know, the drop kick, because what if you miss? You catch nothing but air, you land on the back of your head, and that's going to be all she wrote.
All right, Frankie Burke now finding himself in a tenuous position, not knowing what to do, but...
Tossed out of the ring.
He'll gather his thoughts now.
I wish our commentating table a little further back in the ring, Steve, because a 300-pounder, were he to be propelled with enough force through those ropes towards us, we could wind up sitting underneath him. And this is an outdoor show. I don't want to sit in the dirt covered by a 300-pound individual. How about you?
Well, I've been closer, so I'll take it.
Look at that. Whipped off the rope. Scoop.
Wow.
That's going to be it.
How do you get up from that?
Well, you don't. You don't. And Mokovic showing the kind of strength he has, because he whipped Burke off the rope. The scoop power slam. 300 pounds picking up. 300 pounds coming down on top of you. Boy, oh boy. The count of three doesn't go in. You're some man.
Wow.
Here's the official result. The mad Russian victorious.
Ladies and gentlemen, your winner. The mad Russian.
The mad Russian shocks up another one here on International Championship Wrestling. Milt and I will be back right after this.
Getting better. Rockland, Maine,
People saw what you done to me. Everyone saw what you done to me. I had people coming, knocking on my door, calling me up, sending me telegrams. Are you okay? Are you okay? For a while, I didn't know myself. And I really am not sure if I'll be back at 100%, but I know one thing. In Rockland, Maine, Adrian Street, you're going to get a payback like you've never had before. And as far as your companion, who knows what trick I might have up my sleeve for her. So in Rockland, Maine, with that national TV, you'd be ready.
October 10th at Rockland High School. Don't miss this one. Come and see Dr. D. David Schultz, Jumpin' Joe Savoldi, Exotic Adrian Street, and Mr. USA Tony Atlas. Tickets are available at Kayla's Store, Economy Sports, and Seaport Office Supply. And we'll be taping for national TV, so make sure you're there.
Incognito!
Wrestling, and that is Fabulous Phil Apollo.
You know, we should mention as we take a look that the ICW Heavyweight Championship belt has been held up. Fabulous Phil, the last man that did have it around his waist. And there is tremendous competition here in ICW. Many of them looking for that belt. You consider the likes of the exotic Adrian Street having just recently invaded International Championship Wrestling. Jumpin' Joe Savoldi looking to regain that heavyweight championship belt. The likes of Mr. USA, Tony Atlas, and how about Dr. D himself, David Schultz, from the wrong side of the tracks, the Tennessee Dirt Farmer, and a tougher individual you are going to find nowhere. There are members of the news media who can attest to that fact.
No question. But I'll tell you something, when those belts get held up, they all come flocking, don't they?
They sure do, and they're really, the bell hadn't even run. Fabulous Phil attacking his younger and less experienced opponent, Mike Incognito. Fabulous Phil applauding himself. He likes to do that, doesn't he?
Boy, he's his greatest fan. Body slam Incognito down hard.
Well, you know, you wrestle against a guy like Fabulous Phil, and he does have talent. I guess sometimes you want to remain incognito. Mike, anyway.
That's the famous Incognito family out of Philadelphia, I think.
Well, there's a lot of people who have been incognito throughout the years, and I wonder if they're all relatives.
Oh, look at this. He had, look at Fern Joel and tell him, look, I could have given you three, but he refused.
Ripping Incognito off the ropes. Oh, a solid elbow right to the upper part of the chest, putting Incognito to the canvas. Fabulous Phil, you know something? I wonder if he'd put him away quicker, Steve, if the TV cameras weren't here. I mean, I have a feeling he likes to go home and say, look at me on TV, Ma.
I'll tell you something. Knowing Phil Apollo, if it was just him and his opponent and maybe three people, he'd still do it. He loves to dish out punishment.
Well, there were a lot of bullies that came into professional wrestling, and that was a good, solid, well-placed forearm smash across the jaw. Mike Incognito puts him to the canvas, lifts him up now. It looks to me like he's going to go for the suplex. Now, take a look. You see how he's hooked the tights?
Yeah.
He's not using it the way the ancient Greeks intended it to be done. When Greco-Roman wrestling was established many thousands of years ago. I don't know if you're aware of it, Steve, but we're all aware of the Olympic Games, but at one time in the original ancient Olympics, there was only one sport. That was wrestling.
And what kind of a mat did they use?
It was called grass.
Oh, really? Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
And they wrestled nude. I would imagine there's a member of the audience that would have liked to be in attendance for that.
We may see that on cable someday.
We may see it on conventional.
One,
who knows?
Two, no!
You could see that Fabulous Phil and all his arrogance wasn't going to pin him there. You could see the hand closing around the hair as the count of one was going in. He wants to punish this young fellow a little more. And you know the thing you have to hope? You have to hope it doesn't destroy the desire and the confidence of a young athlete like Mike Incognito. Because here's a young fella that's in obviously good physical condition. He's a young fella just starting out. It's one thing to be defeated, it's another thing to be humiliated. And yet, the only way for a young wrestler to learn his way through this rough, tough business is to get in there against the very, very best. And that's the way you learn. You learn it. It's the school of hard knocks, and that's the only way up. And the other thing that has to be recognized is this, that for every young wrestler to wrestle against an established professional such as the Fabulous Phil Apollo, if he were to score a victory, particularly on television, that's the surest way in the world to get his break, to get the kind of main event type matches that spell the reason everybody comes into this business, and that's money in the bank, brother.
And you know, Milt, as you mentioned again previously, a lot of wrestlers try to go in fresh and abiding by the rules and everything, but gee, when you go up against the Phil Apollo, it's very difficult and frustrating.
Nice move.
Yeah.
Incognito.
Yeah.
Sensing what was coming, hooking his arms around those ropes, didn't come off, and now he's got the opportunity because Apollo's hurting. The question is to follow up, but he tried to do the same thing twice in a row. Apollo, not that he's an old by any means, but has enough ring savvy and experience to recognize when something's about to happen, and he just stepped back. And you saw how Incognito did himself in. The tide of battle in professional wrestling, Steve, as we both know, turns very, very quickly. He can turn on a dime.
Boy, I'll tell you, Incognito's going to learn quickly not to telegraph any of his moves.
Well, he better, or he's going to do nothing but lose matches and perhaps get himself hurt. Yeah.
All right, Apollo now grabbing Incognito again by the hair. Here's another one of those.
That's another form of
something. Yeah, another form.
Now, this is great as a snap.
Ooh, wow.
The fans showing Apollo their disdain for him.
But you got to give him credit, Milt, huh? He does know the moves, and he does execute
them. Well, it all depends on how his balance sheet reads.
True.
As to how much credit you want to give him.
That's true.
Yes, you do. You have to look. A solid clothesline. You can't degrade the man's ability. He was champion. That's got to stand for something. We're not finding fault, nor I think are the fans, with the abilities displayed by Fabulous Phil inside that square circle. I think the only thing anybody finds fault with is his attitude.
Yeah.
You know, it's called arrogance with a capital A and probably a couple of capital R's in there as well.
Yeah.
Now, Incognito on the canvas, Apollo on the second turnbuckle, coming down with that double hammer across the back of the head. And I'll tell you something, in my opinion, it's an awfully lucky thing for Incognito that he saw that coming and kind of rolled back a little because he took away some of the force of that blow. Now another suplex again, and that's a good look at the way he moved the tights, snapped them over and down. Doesn't matter whether he did it right or wrong, it had its own devastating effect, the effect that Apollo was looking for. And there a flying clothesline from the second turnbuckle. The referee down, two and three. Yes, this time he didn't lift the head, and that was a very, very punishing blow. That flying clothesline from the second turnbuckle would have done in a wrestler superior even to Mike Incognito. In this case, though, the former ICW heavyweight champion, Fabulous
Phil. Ladies and gentlemen, your winner, Fabulous Phil Apollo.
Yep, and he knows where that camera is all the time.
Posing.
Look at him.
He wants jumping Joe Savoldi. You know something?
Time Life Music.
At 210 pounds, all the way from Miami Beach, Florida, Eric Sbracchia.
Wow.
they're a happy pair, aren't they?
Boy, I tell you, if you ever want to see someone who's direct from a stable or a corral, as we were talking earlier, look at this. He has shaped and molded Eric Sbracchia into his own image and likeness. Same hairdo, same sunglasses, same attitude.
And where's the belt? Well, engaging in a little bit of a verbal diatribe with the fans and gathered at ringside and a very healthy crowd here. But the fans, I'm not sure if they're totally aware who Eric Sbracchia is going to be facing.
I don't think Phil Apollo's aware of it.
And it's going to be a lot of fun when the music starts and he makes his entrance, because it's a fan favorite that we all know, loved and adored by fans throughout the world of wrestling. And it just may be a little bit too much for Eric Sbracchia to bite off and chew in his match.
Phil Apollo and Eric Sbracchia awaiting the arrival. Here he comes.
Listen to the reception.
From Fort Lauderdale, Florida,
former ICW Heavyweight Champion, Jumpin' Joe Savoldi. And Phil was not ready for this. And Eric Sbracchia was not ready for this.
The two of them beating a relatively hasty retreat from the ring. Hit the bell, the referee says. The match officially underway.
Savoldi wants both of them, but I know who he'd love to have in there.
Nobody with the robes off yet. Jumpin' Joe gets the robe off inside the ring. Sbracchia and his good buddy and mentor, Fabulous Phil, outside the ring. Sbracchia finally has his robe off. He's on the ring apron, and Jumpin' Joe is obviously ready for action, wouldn't you say, Steve?
Milt, there have been a lot of rivalries in sports, and this is coming close to one of the greatest. These two guys have gone at it tooth and nail time and time again, and they're relatively young. I can see these guys going at it for another 20 years if they want to.
if they both survive it.
That's right.
Oh, Sbracchia beating a real hasty retreat. We just saw the timeout signal given by Fabulous Phil. And isn't it funny how so many wrestlers, when they want the time off, give that little signal for the timeout, and they know it doesn't exist, not in this game.
All right, Joe Savoldi is popping mad.
Well, the danger here, you know, is that he's going to burn the adrenaline out, get himself pumped up a little bit too much, waiting for the opponents, and then be a little bit drained, perhaps, by the time the opponent gets in there. Sbracchia is finally inside the squared circle, the two of them facing each other, wearily, cagily, locking up now, collar elbow hookup, Jumpin' Joe force back against the ropes, but he managed to reverse the circumstance, broke cleanly. Sbracchia, with his head out of the ropes, telling the people how smart he is. I'd like to talk to his grade 3 teacher and see if his marks were indicative of the kind of intelligence he's claiming.
Joe knows what Eric Sbracchia is all about right now. They've met many, many other times, but not like this.
Whoa! Solid left hand haymaker by Jumpin' Joe.
A hard left by Joe Savoldi.
Well, it's time for a little tete-a-tete inside the ring between Sbracchia, the man who's actually wrestling this match, and his mentor and good buddy Fabulous Phil. They're like two chips off the old block, you know, or two worms under a rock, whatever you want to call them. I think that's the way the fans regard both of them.
Sbracchia was holding his nose and trying to get it back into place and reset it.
Locking up a referee position, collar elbow hook.
Beautiful
up and arm drag.
Yeah.
Second arm drag by Jumpin' Joe. What's with this timeout? You know, this is what I don't understand. Yet it is. It's not unsound, circumstances. It's not unsound judgment on their parts to be outside.
Oh, no.
What? Oh, no. All the fans in attendance really enjoyed that.
Oh, I have never seen Joe deliver such punches in my life as he has done right here.
Well, sometimes, you know, you're looking for reasons to do things. And if the feeling between them is as you have described, why not?
I'll second that.
You know, we said it what before, we'll say it again. The name of this game, it's like Christmas time. Giving is so much better than receiving.
Yes, sir. All right, Sbracchia now.
Preferring the hand of friendship, and do you believe it, Mr. Bud? If you were jumping Joe very quickly, would you shake the hand being offered?
Watch, Joe. Just watch. I have a... Look at this. He'll have none of it.
Well,
I was going to get back to an earlier point, Milt. A lot of times, maybe another possible rules change would be that if a wrestler goes out of the ring of his own volition, maybe make the count a little bit quicker.
Whoa, look at that big high backdrop. Wow. Sbracchia propelled. He had to be 5 or 6 feet up in the air, came down heavily, took the full force of the bro, and look at the reaction. Look at the reaction to Sacroiliac being rubbed and massaged by Fabulous Phil outside the ring. I'll tell you something, if you don't think that it hurts to go that high up in the air and come down that hard, all it is underneath there, man, you've got canvas, you've got plywood, and you're coming down there awfully, awfully hard, because it's up and it's down, and when you go up that far and there's 200 odd pounds up there, you come down a lot quicker than you go up.
Well, Sbracchia now with a little bit of dirt on his trunks, and he's going to probably experience a lot more suffering and pain if I know Joe.
There's an arm bar with a twist and a half, jumping Joe. Take a look, he's putting another twist on.
Ooh.
Now, the fans wonder, why does the man kind of flip over as he does? Simple, self-preservation. There was a twist and a half already on the arm. Jumpin' Joe went underneath, put another twist on it. You can't survive 2.5 twists. All your shoulder is a ball joint, and it's gonna come out of the socket.
Boy, Joe almost did it right there, coming down hard. Joe will do this too, as many wrestlers, great wrestlers, will do. They'll start working on a particular part of the body and stay with it.
Well, that's the thing to do. You want to immobilize your opponent. Now, in the case of a young, not overly heavy opponent such as a Sbracchia, being built very similar to Joe, Joe's not really going to be able to take the legs away. He's too young, he's too strong. But work on an arm like that, immobilize him. It becomes almost paralytic, and eventually it's going to, in the due course, because you know with wrestlers of this caliber and of this age and with the kind of physical condition that they enjoy, you know that the match is going to be a 2 or 3 minute match. You know that they're going to go. So immobilize the man. Take away half of his body, and in this case, it's the left arm. Jumpin' Joe going after his arch rival there, Fabulous Phil. And there's a danger, you know. The danger is not the fact that Fabulous Phil may necessarily interfere, which is, you know, quite possible, the mere fact that he's there, and you know the feeling between the two, but the distractive element to Jumpin' Joe is what can wreak havoc on his mind. And if he starts paying more attention to Fabulous Phil than he does to Sbracchia, that in itself could spell defeat for Jumpin' Joe, although he sure controlled this match to date.
Wow, Joe with another hard left sends Sbracchia down, and now his head is going to take a series of knocks here, and each turnbuckle, perhaps.
Well, it looks like Joe wants to make him familiar with each corner because he whipped him into a third.
Oh, no!
Caution to the winds, and Jumpin' Joe paid for that, Steve. Sbracchia showing that he still has his wits about him.
Joe going flying into that post. Look at Phil. Phil trying to sneak up on Joe. Look at this.
Choking him at ringside. The referee being distracted by Sbracchia as Fabulous Phil showing us just the kind of arrogant attitude we've all come to expect from him at all times. Now, the tide of battle so quickly turns in this rep match as we've seen it turn in others. Jumpin' Joe slammed to the canvas. Sbracchia misses the leg drop. Jumpin' Joe showing us his eyes are still wide open. Rolling out at the last second.
Another hard left. Ropes.
Dropping down, Sbracchia over top. That's
the
belly suplex.
There you go, yep. That's it.
Count of three goes
That's
in.
That's it,
Lockwood. Oh, holding a second. Fabulous Phil Pearl Harbor shuffling Joe from behind as his hand went up in the air, but he's going to pay for it. It's called tit for tat. The glasses are gone, and he's taking lefts and right. Whoa, a drop kick, and Fabulous Phil over top of the top rope right in front of us. I would just say that it was a double victory scored by Jumpin' Joe right here at this match tonight. Eric Sbracchia, the official loser. Fabulous Phil, the unofficial loser.
And Joe waiting for more, inviting them back. Sbracchia and Apollo. Look, Phil's going up on that top stepping, and you gotta be kidding.
Well, we'll see. Maybe we'll have two matches right here involving Jumpin' Joe. No.
Look at this.
We'll get you some other time, and you know something? That's the right attitude. That's the professional attitude to take. They'll have lots more chances inside that squared circle. Steve, but I hope we're there to cover it. Wrestling fans, Jumpin' Joe Savoldi victorious. There's an awful lot more action yet to come. Stay with us. We'll be back.
The man of the hour, the man with the power, the man too sweet to be sour, Fabulous Phil Apollo coming back to Bangor, Maine, October the 9th. Joe Savoldi, didn't you get enough the last time? Haven't I humiliated you once, humiliated you twice, disgraced you in your second home in Maine? How many times do I have to beat you? How many times do I have to pin your scrawny little shoulders to the mat before you learn? I am the champion. I'm the man that beat you for the belt in the first place. I am the only man that you have yet to defeat. And my winning streak goes on and on and on.
October 9th, get down to the Bangor Auditorium for Dr. D. David Schultz, Jumpin' Joe Savoldi, the exotic Adrian Street, and Mr. USA Tony Atlas, and the best wrestlers in the ICW. You can get your tickets at the auditorium or Sandy's downtown. For more information, call 942-9000.
Comrade, look! Amerikanskis all over U.S. of A. are receiving this letter from HBO.